Hello and welcome to this special edition of The Big Picture with me, Frank Razam Pereira, on Rajya Sabha Television. On the fourth anniversary of his government, Prime Minister Narendra Modi on Saturday listed its achievements, saying that over the past 4 years, development had become a vibrant mass movement. With the hashtag Saaf Niyat Saaf Sahi Vikas, Modi also posted a series of charts, graphics and a video to underline the achievements of his government. The Prime Minister stressed that his government would continue to serve the people with the same vigour and dedication. Modi said that with complete integrity, the best intent, his government had taken futuristic and people-friendly decisions that were laying the foundations of a new India. On this special edition of The Big Picture, we will take stock of 4 years of Modi Sarkar. Joining me on the programme today are Sushma Yadav, Professor of Public Policy and Governance, IIPA, Chakshu Roy, Head of Outreach, PRS Legislative Research, Nitin Sethi, Senior Associate Editor, Business Standard, and Dr. Tajamul Haq, Chairman, Special Cell on Land Policies, Niti Aayog. Thank you to all my guests for joining me on this edition of The Big Picture. Chakshu, I'd like to begin with you. How would you look back at 4 years of Modi Sarkar?
Frank, the area of where I work is Parliament and the two
Indeed,
houses
yeah.
of Parliament. If I look at the work that has happened in the 4 years, there are two things that stand out. One is, in previous Lok Sabhas, one would often wonder that Parliament was a forum for transacting government business. So there has been a little bit of a shift there. Both houses of Parliament have witnessed debates beyond the legislative debates, and the percentage of those debates have increased. The contentious issue there is that on a number of occasions there's been a fair bit of political back and forth before the debates could be agreed upon, and the other part is that for the last three sessions of Parliament there has been a fair bit of contentious parliamentary proceedings. So the shift in debate, not only from government business, but to discussions other than government-led discussions, is one thing that I have seen in the last 4 years. The other part, and this is probably where Nitin can also pitch in because he works for a business newspaper, is the amount of financial sector legislation. If you look at the numbers, the legislation piloted by the finance ministry have been on a slightly higher side. To give you an example, a marquee example that the Prime Minister quotes for bipartisanship in Parliament is the GST, where all political parties gather together. There are a number of other, some contentious, some not so contentious. The 30% tax on foreign undisclosed income, the black money bill, was another one of them. The bankruptcy code, which put together the mechanism for corporate and personal bankruptcy, that came into play. There was a Benami properties for confiscation of them. The law was ineffective. A bill was passed to make that operational. So the amount of financial legislation that have gone through Parliament in the last 4 years is something which is which I've not seen in the other parliaments. But has everything in parliamentary functioning been, went smoothly? Not always.
Sure.
An example of that could be that there have been bills which have, which haven't cleared Parliament. And the reason for that is that the government has not been able to build consensus on some of those issues. The land acquisition bill, which was, introduced, the land acquisition amendment, which was introduced, I think, in 2014 and then through ordinance in 2015 is one example of that. So the last 4 years, have seen a fair bit of legislative business, but we also need to keep in mind that the last year of the last parliament saw a big ticket reform legislation come in. The Companies Law, the Companies Bill was passed in 2013. The Food Security Act was passed in 2013. The Land Acquisition was again passed in 2013. So we have two more sessions of Parliament left for this year. So it would be interesting to see as to what are those other marquee legislation that the government would try to, pass through this.
Indeed. Talking about business in the Parliament to what's happening outside, Nitin Sethi, the opposition has said that it is very disappointed in 4 years of Modi Sarkar thus far and believes that the people have not been taken along. How would you look at 4 years, and do you think that the opposition has a point in the issues that they are raising?
So I think the question really, Frank, is by what benchmark do you measure the performance of the current Prime Minister? Is it the benchmark set by usual politics or the fact that this Prime Minister does present a disruption to the way politics is run? And I think that is essential to understanding or even trying to assess where the government's gone in 4 years. I don't think either the opposition or anyone else has a doubt that the Prime Minister is one of the most popular figures, political figures we've seen in a long while. That he's also a bit of a polarizing figure, consequently, is also evident at the same time. That he sets large target-oriented deliveries at a very centralized control is also essentially evident across the board. That presents different kind of challenges for this government. Say it has on the social front at one point presented an array of targets on schemes that already existed, but he was able to personalize them and create at the early stages of his tenure a sense of public involvement. So in sense, trying to pass a civic responsibility on to the citizen of engaging and being as responsible for delivery of those schemes. Clearly, the benchmarks that were set, it was difficult for the government to achieve. And we are seeing this across the board in different schemes. The benchmarks were far above what was probably even achievable. And the rhetoric on those schemes was a little far beyond that as well.
Was it because we were too ambitious? Did the government set too ambitious a target?
So that, I think, it cuts both ways. If you have a good, large, big target, it helps you go further away from where you started, but it also creates a huge tension of achieving those targets and not looking at overall if the scheme's working or not. I think that's been a challenge for this government across various schemes. Laudable ideas that should have worked, but maybe at times the cart was put before the horse. If you're talking of digital India and you're not looking at electrification, and if you're saying 24 hours electricity and you know it doesn't exist, these are challenges that any government would have faced. I think the opposition's got a mark in to scream loudly about it simply because the rhetoric built around these achievements has been much higher than anyone else ever claimed. So I think in some sense, politically, the Prime Minister is very successful. He is able to claim more credit relative to what he's achieved. And he's able to do that very well. I don't think the previous governments were able to even milk what they'd done well when they did. That said, there's also been a large structural problem with the government of how it handles the economy. Mm. To give you one example, when the Prime Minister came in, he accepted the recommendations of the 14th Finance Commission, which said we'll provide more unhinged funds to the states as part of his mantra of saying states, we are a federal structure where the states have more role than the center, or at least play an equal role. Remember, this is the politics he built when he came into power. Now, when we sit in 2018, the government is trying to revise that structure now. The 15 Finance Commission terms of reference say, maybe we should not give this money. We should check whether so much money should go to the states or not. Now, what to my mind it suggests is lack of clarity of how to handle economy at scale. Mm. This government's quite far more capable of handling projects. It's a project delivery government which works very well. Therefore, the target orientation of different schemes also presents its own problems. But structurally, looking at an economy, looking at these large components come together, I think is the government's faced several challenges on several fronts, and there its weakness shows up. And I think the consequences have been then when this government came in the early window period when the oil prices were low.
Right.
It was a golden era. It was a golden opportunity for the government to kind of bounce back from the problems of the previous UPA government, particularly last 2 years of UPA government. I think we lost that window of opportunity.
Okay. Missed opportunity as far as the oil is concerned.
On several fronts, I think it's lack of understanding of how to deal with it, instead focusing on a project-oriented basis, which perhaps works very well at a state level. I think that's been a cause. But again, I must admit, despite these structural failures in the policy, the Prime Minister's popularity overall seems to be unhinged from the rest of his performance. Mm. Which is fascinating for me sociologically.
Okay. Let me bring in the professor on the program now. You know, professor, as far as the social sector is concerned, How would you look back at the social sector? What have been our biggest achievements over the last 4 years?
I think if we look at the social sector, and I'll bring education and health on it also, and since I also belong to the education sector, I'll start with that. The government did make big promises, but it has also been able to work on them. And if you begin from school education, the school education when the government took over was almost like in a state of shambles. Why I say state of shambles? Because there were no outcomes ensured. And the school education was rated by almost all the different agencies who were working there as something which just was not showing any progress. So now graded learning, learning outcomes are being ensured. I won't say have been ensured, but are being ensured by this government. And the MHRD is specially trying to bring out graded learning outcomes clearly, which can be evaluated, and an evaluation system also. Now, if we move on, and there are remedial classes which have been there, but are not being ensured for the backward or marginalized sections, are also being ensured at that level. If we go to education, otherwise, education has been expanded, but expanded much more. Because if you look at 7 IITs, 7 IIMs, 14 IIITs, I think that's a huge expansion. So they're trying to take education to the masses. And I would say that one promise which every government used to make and every institution looks at was the autonomy issue. Although there are different kinds of responses and reactions, but I think the government has brought a legislation or brought a scheme. We passed through UGC a graded autonomy scheme, and where we have really graded universities and the A category universities which have come out through a great, you know, great selection process have been given autonomy to appoint teachers, to you know, expand their students' base, to start new courses without coming to UGC or any other regulatory agencies when they fulfill all the qualifications. That they have done. They've also tried to ensure the quality of ODL, which was left completely unattended all these years. So the ODL has been regulated. We only have to see that it doesn't get regulated too much.
Too much, yeah.
Too much, but regulation was required. And so we have brought that regulation also. And now we are also trying to look at issues where the deemed to be universities and private universities which were working and were working almost like, you know, in an open space, they also come into some kind of regulation, quality control, ranking system, and also completely be in a kind of sync with the rest of university system, so that those students who are a bit, I would say, underprivileged, who go to these universities, pay more, get less, are also regulated and their degrees also get recognized.
Right.
So I think it's a lot that the government has started doing. And if you look at the social sector, I think it's a huge budget which this government has really allocated. If you look at the recognition and identity issues, then Ambedkar International Center has come up at the heart of New India or Delhi, and the Ambedkar Memorial at Alipur has been renovated, and really it gives a great sense of identity to those who are looking at these memorials, because they are memorials which, you know, give a strength or maybe feeling of empowerment to those people. They have libraries, they have research centers, so we think we also bring on board those sections who are almost like out of the research and higher education every now.
Right, right. Let me bring in Dr. Tajamul Haq into the picture now. You know, Dr. Haq, as far as the government is concerned, would you say that the agriculture sector was the Achilles heel for the Modi Sarkar over the last 4 years?
Yeah, I think in the field of agriculture, I think one can clearly see that for the first time, the government has set a definitive goal of doubling farmers' income over, say, 2014-15 and to 2020-22. So I think earlier there was no such definitive goal of achieving that kind of target. So now that for that, efforts also are on. And in fact, we are working out a mechanism how, for instance, the minimum support price based on 50% margin over total cost can be implemented for all crops in all the regions, and some kind of institutional mechanism is being evolved. So I think that itself will be a very big thing in terms of improving farmers' income, and also in bringing about a change in the rural economy. This is one. Second thing, also you will find that not just MSP, but even for some region, if MSP cannot be implemented, the private traders, you know, can procure it at MSP, and the difference between the market price and the MSP will be compensated by the government. This is the second thing. Third thing is that the government in the last 4 years have also tried to see how a national market for agricultural commodities can be created, for which ENAM concept has been developed. In about 585 markets, we are now trying to have electronic auctioning and open auctioning in a very transparent manner. And also the stocks of market integration, that is what farmers need basically, is that market access. Whatever they produce, they should get the best price for that. And for that, now 585 markets have been integrated. And also there is now an attempt to integrate 22,000 rural hearts with these major 585 markets. So I think this itself will bring about a transformative change in the rural economy. And third thing is that you have seen public investment in agriculture has been increased very substantially, more so in irrigation. Irrigation, in fact, Pradhan Mantri Krishi Sinchai Yojana, the focus is that whatever the pending projects were there for several years, 20, 30 years, so those projects will be completed in the next few years. Already some 15, 16 projects have been completed. And fourthly, the irrigation use efficiency, there is a focus like drip irrigation, sprinkler irrigation, which will reduce the cost of production of the farmers. Along with that, you also find that there is a focus on organic farming so that there is a balanced use of nutrients.
Right.
The fertilizer subsidy now also will go directly to the farmers, not the way it was working earlier through the dealers or through your fertilizer companies. Sixth thing, what I have is the neem-coated urea, which again reduces or stops the diversion of urea and leads to the proper use of urea only by the farmers. And fourthly, you'll also find that the government has given soil health card to all farmers. About 80% farmers have been covered by now. Another 20% will be covered in the next few years. And based on soil characteristics of a particular plot, farmers now will apply chemical fertilizers or organic fertilizers or micro nutrients, whatever is needed, zinc, sulfur, potash, whatever. So what I'm saying that a very clear kind of things, I think, is emerging in the agriculture sector.
Okay.
Immediately, you may find that probably...
Points taken, Dr. Huck. The government is doing enough as far as the agriculture sector is concerned, is what you're saying. Clear picture is emerging for that particular sector, and it looks like everything will fall in place, is what you're suggesting. Chakshu Roy, let's take the discussion forward and talk about the next 1 year. Now, it's an election year. What is it that the government's focus area will be over the next year? What are some of the crucial bills it would like to see sail through Parliament, and what will it focus on?
Frank, I'm going to take forward the conversation that Professor Saab was talking about on higher education, right? If you look at the last 4 years of legislation that have been piloted in Parliament, one of the areas where legislation has not been as much is the higher education sector, right? We've seen a number of university bills passed, and in 2017 there was the IIM bill passed, which gave a large scale, gave a fair bit of autonomy to the IIMs. So I think higher education could be one area where the government could look at as to what it's planning to do. It could be around overhauling UGC, and there's been some cabinet discussions around that. There has been discussions about accreditation agencies. In the previous Lok Sabha, it still hasn't gone through. So that could be another possible area. The government has legislation around the labor code. There were different pieces of the labor code. One piece is still in Parliament, which is called the wages, which is going to provide a base for wages in the country. In terms of legislative agenda, which is pending, there is the Consumer Protection Bill, which is pending, the FRDI Bill, which is going to provide some kind of a monitoring framework for financial institutions, is there. In terms of what could come, you know, there has been conversations about a revamped tax code.
Right.
So that could be another thing that could, you know, come into play.
Sure.
On the institutional side of things, you know, I was writing something, and I discovered that the chairman of Rajya Sabha has appointed a committee to look at the revising the rules of Rajya Sabha. So that could be. It hasn't happened in the last, you know, 7-8 years. So that could be an important development that could potentially come through before the monsoon session.
Sure. You know, Professor, being an election year, do you believe that the government is going to be serious about the social sector? Do you believe that that's a sector that's going to get the needed importance, needed attention?
I think the government will have to and should, because the expansion of social security, which they started with, the expansion of schemes which really focus on women issues or women empowerment, as we say, I won't say women empowerment, but women well-being is good enough. So well-being of women, and especially it has to ensure, because over these last 4 years there is an impression among the marginalized sections that some of their securities and some of their special provisions are being weakened or taken away. I'm sure the government will look at that and will try to strengthen them, because its motto is Sabka Saath Sabka Vikas, and it also talk about social harmony, not only justice and empowerment. And one, I think, side was that this time the social sector budget was highest over the years, more than 95,000 crores, and it has to expand the health also. I would say social security, Jan Oshadhi, and the loans to women, Mudra, under Mudra, and to the marginalized sections, they will go up, and the government would like to bring in certain legislations also to completely demonstrate that it doesn't really mean to take away the privileges, but of course it wants the society to be together,
right,
stronger and in harmony.
Sure. You know, Nitin, as far as the next 1 year is concerned, crucial state elections coming up later this year, and then we have the big one in 2019. What do you think the government is going to focus on?
Well, I can tell you what I hope it doesn't focus on. I hope it doesn't launch more schemes. I think there is a lot of pending agenda that this government's opened up. It's caused problems as well. It's caused two structural upheavals in 4 years, demonetization and GST, a badly implemented and a principally wrongly constructed GST. It's recovering. Our economy at this stage is recovering. We're also seeing oil prices jump to a scale where the government's fiscal will be really constrained. I hope it knows that this is not the time to launch another plethora of schemes. It's already promised a private sector-based insurance mechanism for health. I think it's a dangerous step to take, but the government has at the moment. I think instead of investing in public health, moving towards private dependence and insurance-based mechanisms, we know across the world it's not work. I think for the government at this stage, I would presume they're going to work on saying we've delivered free houses, we're going to deliver you electricity, we're going to deliver you health. The agriculture, despite the plethora of schemes that is launched across the board, there have been failures or problems in that area. And yet we see that demand in rural India has actually jumped at the same time. So there are two rural Indias in some sense. There is non-farm sector and farm sector. We're seeing there's a difference between that. I don't think the government's been able to map that well, which is why we've had problems in Madhya Pradesh and Rajasthan earlier. We've seen riots happen in those places. Now both these states will go into election. Clearly the government will be on its back foot to try and provide farm loan waivers like were promised in Karnataka. That's a huge shave off on the economy. Actually, so if you look at the promise that the BJP made in Karnataka, the amount that they were offering as loan waiver was more than the capital investment the BJP government would make in Karnataka on agriculture and irrigation and rural development put together.
Right.
Now, these are in a populist year, and this is a year for populist decisions. It's going to be very difficult for this government to not bite this down this road, and I hope it doesn't. I hope it sticks on to what it's already started off. There's too much it started off. Hopefully it can just calm down rather than, you know, expand more.
Right.
I think, and this also is true, as Ms. Yadav was saying, of the social schism that we've seen in society. Hopefully if we can find that the politics, BJP finds its politics works as better, without polarization, that its delivery of its whatever achievement it has works more in its favor than other elements of its politics. I think that would be much better in this year, particularly because we're going to go through a strange period when economically we're not going to be as comfortable as, say, 5 years, 4 years sure. ago when this government came.
Sure. Haq Saab, you know, as the agriculture sector has been in a lot of distress, and we've seen several protests, several farmers committing suicides as well. Over the next 1 year, what do you believe the government's focus should be?
Government, I think, is not lacking or lagging in any respect as far as agriculture sector is concerned. Only thing is that you can see during the last 4 years, 2 years were very bad in the sense from weather point of view. I mean, one year was completely a drought year. The another year in 2015-16 also was almost a similar bad situation. So, and despite that, you will find that the because of emphasis on irrigation and you know other schemes that the government have developed, I think there is so much of resilience that the food production went down only by a small margin, quantity. In fact, it was hardly 6 to 7 million tons less as compared to what used to be earlier. In 2002 drought, if you see, the production of you know food grain itself was less by 31 million tons. And as on today, you find that agriculture has developed so much of resilience because of some of the measures that have been taken that we don't have to worry so much about agriculture is concerned. But certainly, on the price front, there was an issue. The government is trying to address this. As I said, if the government can really implement this minimum support price based on total cost plus 50% margin, that itself will change the scenario completely.
Right.
Second thing is that unfortunately, sometimes what happens during the election year, there will be so much of politics that some of the very important reforms get stalled or do not move, even if the government wants to do it from the point of view of its long-term positive impact. For instance, I will tell you the APMC reforms, which the new APMC Act has come. So, but I'm sure because of the election, I think many of the things will not be taken up or will not be pushed aggressively. Similarly, the land leasing reform, we have passed a model land leasing act. I mean, we have framed a model land leasing act in Niti Aayog. Some of the states, irrespective of their political color, they have adopted it. Uttar Pradesh during Samajwadi rule.
Points taken.
During Congress
Points taken, Haq Saab. I've got very limited time on the program, so I'm going to get quick closing comments from all my guests. In 30 seconds, I'm going to ask my other guests to conclude the show as well. Starting with you, Chakshu Roy.
Frank, I'd like to see a lot more deliberation happen in Parliament, even though even if lesser legislation get passed, I would really like to see both houses of Parliament deliberate on issues comprehensively.
Right. Professor.
I would say the programs that we have started, the projects that the government has taken up and the policies that they have already made need to be really implemented. And with quality, the quantity also goes on
sure.
because we have to take all of them together. And women issues really have to be taken very, very seriously and carefully.
Right. Nitin.
I think it's important this year to recover from the economic and social, the disruption to the economic and social structures that we've had in the last 4 years. It's important to stabilize and now calm down rather than go through another crazy phase of doing too many things at the same time. And I hope the government does this.
Okay. Haq Saab, close the show for us with your concluding remarks.
Yeah, concluding remarks is that now the government is focusing on convergence and coordination so that all the existing schemes can be more effectively and efficiently implemented and the results will be better. So I think in that way, I think we are moving in the right direction.
Okay, all right. On that note, then we'll call it a wrap on this edition of The Big Picture. Thank you to all my guests for joining me on the program and putting things into perspective for us. That's it from me. See you again next time.